My name is Bas Pedrol, from Holland. You wouldn't expect a person from Holland in a conference on terraces, because our country is flat. So we don't have slopes, and we don't have terraces either. But I'm very much a European guy, so I'm very much interested in the beautiful landscapes that make our assets in Europe. And like we heard, it's not only in Europe that we have terraces, it's all over the world. It's a sort of lifestyle which we tend to forget, which is so important. Well, we don't have a lot of time, but I have a few questions to you. I think we missed one person, isn't it?
Yeah. Juan Anton is not calling.
Ah, he's not calling. Well, he was perhaps one of the most interesting guys. because he was talking about aligning new architecture to the lines and the forms and the creators of the foreign landscapes. And I would like to have asked him how he would do with public participation. But we won't touch upon that then, because we had two other very interesting talks about the art and the philosophy and the spirituality of making dry stone walls, which I think was very interesting. To those presenters, I would like to ask, what would you see as the role of architecture in developing the vision of the future of the dry stone walls? But then we had also another, maybe more historical view on architecture and the role of architecture in the landscape in the Gobi Valley. And there, I think, is also very important the point of view of, well, what is the vision to the future? So I would like to ask you about the future vision that you could derive from the work of the architects that have been engaged in developing constructions that fit well or not very well in the landscape of the Douro Valley, which is so beautiful when you show them your pictures. And then the last, of course, not the last, but another historical account was about the archaeology. Are those terraces from after the Conquista, or are there already some traces of before? Also there, I would ask, well, what would this mean for a future say design of the landscapes of those areas where perhaps there is some archaeological remains, but still, well, you have to build on and you have to reconstruct your roads and your terraces, etc. And the very last one, that was a very interesting one, is more a technical problem, not even of dry stone walls. I think perhaps also for dry stone walls, but mainly for cemented walls, a sort of escape route. Well, once they are degraded anyway, then there's still something to do. And I would like to ask you, is this really something for future, or should you think of, just let them degrade, because that's also life. Okay, so please.
I forgot
the question.
The role of architects. You know why? Because I don't consider myself a real architect. So I have a background in architecture. And the role of architect, I think of myself, so forgive my sort of egotistic approach, is to have the big view. So I always think that if I'm working on what I'm working, it's not because I'm designing new construction. It's not because I'm looking only at one particular element of the landscape, but because somehow I think architects have the composition mind. So they are putting different elements and try to have the shape that is the project. So the role of architect, to me, that I'm not building, sort of designing new architecture, could be that of interpreting as well. So being a sort of a connecting ring within the chain, that as well is translating what is the language of the architecture and the language of the landscape, and then try to connect that sort of guidelines, and then discuss them with the social kind of with the communities. So that is something in between, and that could be helping very much the understanding, reciprocal understanding, and as well to share what is the maybe one of the best choices for moving towards the future and recognizing where we are and what is precious to us today.
Yeah, thank you very much. Okay,
right.
You can continue now.
Yeah. I agree with Donato now, and I said that it's very important to look in ancestral know-how to take what is the best for the future and to adapt that to the future, and always have connected with artisans, with engineers, with agriculture, with to discuss about the landscape, because architects is not alone. And if I said you must be like that because it's a good way, and if artisans are not agree, or agriculture are not agree, or other architects are don't understand, it's impossible. We must always together for collective art.
¿Puedo hablar en español? La cuestión es que nosotros pensamos que hoy la arquitectura, como en todos los tiempos, tiene que tener la capacidad de construir para los hombres de hoy, ¿no? Y pensó que nunca podríamos hacer una arquitectura que hace mímesis o hace muñas, ¿se dice? ¿No? Del cotidiano, ¿no? No nos interesa esto, ¿no? Al contrario, la cuestión es cómo nos colocamos haciendo una interpretación de las formas del pasado, no de las formas desde el punto de vista de la formalización, más de las formas de vivir, ¿no? Que conectan cuestiones muy más complejas y abstractas, ¿no?, que la forma en términos de moda, ¿no? Y cómo esta interpretación de la forma de habitar, de las culturas, de los lugares, no solo de las culturas de los lugares, más también del carácter, de la física que está intrínseca a la geometría, al clima, a la geografía, a que lo que es la geología de los lugares, ¿no? Cómo esto viene transformado en formas de la arquitectura, en formas de habitar. Y esto me parece que hoy nosotros tenemos un conocimiento demasiado grande, ¿no? Yo pienso que para nosotros hoy nada ya es imposible. Todo lo que imaginamos ya lo podemos hacer, ¿no? Entonces, la cuestión es cómo tornar a propor. Yo pienso que la arquitectura está en un momento de cruce muy grande, ¿no? Yo diría que los japoneses están, tal vez porque han iniciado muy más temprano que todos nosotros una evolución tecnológica, ¿no? Están encontrando respuestas muy adecuadas a la relación entre la respuesta contemporánea de la arquitectura a un entendimiento muy ancestral de la felicidad del hombre, ¿no? Y la cuestión es esta, ¿no? ¿Cómo? Yo pienso que el arquitecto tiene que formarse para conseguir dar respuesta a los sueños del hombre, más a los sueños del hombre de su tiempo, ¿no? Con el material que tiene disponible y con el conocimiento que hay.
Casi comenzaría con una pregunta más, vamos a decir, y lo que queda del pasado lo incorporamos a la vida de hoy de alguna forma o solamente un error. Y ahí sería quizá mi observación, y es, tenemos que entender ya por fin la arquitectura como, no como un opuesto, un diálogo entre conservar la arquitectura, intervenir más en conservar o tirar y hacer nuevo. No sé si el punto intermedio que es rehabilitar, reusar, revolver, porque realmente eso, y así lo han dicho ya, ya tenían esa observancia hace décadas, pero la generación al siglo XXI va a ser un siglo de poco construir nuevo, hecho nuevo, sino volver a mirar lo que ya existe, porque no podemos seguir fagocitando territorio a base de crear nuevo territorio. Tenemos un territorio ya hecho. Igual pasa con las ciudades históricas. Las ciudades históricas hay que reusarlas. Hacer barrios enteros, todos conocemos en todas las ciudades, barrios que se vienen abajo, que colapsan, no tienen funciones, se vacían de funciones y se van a centros comerciales, y sin embargo la ciudad sigue creciendo. No tiene sentido. Por eso hay ejemplos que ha dado la historia, como por ejemplo los alcaldes, baratas, las terrestres, que nos ofrecen un modo de hacer arquitectura, un modo de habitar, un modo de ocupar un paisaje y un modo de ser. Ahora se usa mucho más sostenible, es justamente eso. El problema, este elemento es, ¿qué ocurre con esas momias del pasado cuando la vida urbana normal llega a ella? Una vida, todos estamos de acuerdo, absolutamente normal, normativizada hasta el extremo. Como por ejemplo esos muros de albarrado que por normativa local nos prohíben que se pueda extraer piedras, que no pueden usar, o que sean, que no se puedan escalar. No tocan ni más. Porque intervenir implica anular la propia esencia del muro de albarrado. Pero se sigue la normativa y una vida más. Si sube un niño, si era niño, pequeño la culpa, como siempre. Es un problema, y es un problema ser un problema de sensibilidad, pero como todo, creo que se ha avanzado mucho en la sensibilización social sobre el patrimonio. Y ya no solamente el monumento, sino el cambio mental de que el patrimonio es más que un monumento, creo que ha sido fenomenal, y es una conquista que creo que se ha conseguido.
Well, I'm afraid I don't have much to add to the discussion. Just to say that I suppose it's about finding a balance between heritage preservation and development, between what is valuable about our past and what do we need for the future. But we should think very carefully about what we mean with development and what do we really need to do for the future. And also be aware that, as he said, that the past was never something monolithic. The landscape we exist is not the result of an original design that has been given to us. It's the result of an evolution of centuries or thousands of years, and many times it's a traumatic one. And so, in that sense, I think we should preserve enough to remember the traumas of the past and the lessons from the past.
Una cosa, una posibilidad que nos dieron era colocar vidrios delante del muro para que no se pudiera subir.
Well, thank you very much for this point after the thinkings of your talks this afternoon. Thank you very much for your insightful talks. You make also a very nice connection between knowledge of this morning and labor of this afternoon. This morning, Enrico Fontanari said, well, landscape is not something fixed. Like, and you all have also underlined this point.
talking about labor, but we still have a lot to do. And I can illustrate it with an anecdote which was told to me by a good colleague, Yves Michelin from France. He taught, he's teaching landscape science in Clermont-Ferrand. And he asked his students, well, can you make interviews in your study area in the landscape about what people think of landscape, what is their perception of landscape? And they make interviews and they talk with all those people, the farmers especially, but the farmers, they didn't know what is landscape. And in the end, what do you think of this landscape? And they said, well, what do you mean with landscape? And then in the end, there was a very clever student, and he said, okay, I'll know it another way. And the next time he asked the farmer, okay, if you wake up this morning and you open the curtains and you look out of the window, what do you see? A lot of work to do. That's labor. So I would like to close the session with that. Thank you very much, all of the audience, and see you tomorrow.